As someone born in the late 1980s, I'm one of the last generations of people who can clearly recall life without the internet. Getting dial-up internet at home and starting to use the internet regularly at school were really big deals, and I remember them very clearly. Although we can easily articulate the benefits of the information age and easy access to the internet, there are some pretty serious negatives, especially in the realm of science communication. It's not uncommon when talking about science and science communication that at some point, someone is going to bring up either mis or disinformation. In this lesson, we'll learn about mis and disinformation, how it spreads, and what we can do about it. First, what do I mean by mis and disinformation? Both refer to the spread of false information. The key difference between the two is the intent with which that information was spread. With misinformation, think someone saying, "I was misinformed about that." Someone legitimately believes something to be true and tells others because they believe that they are correct. There is no malicious intent of spreading the information. While it's certainly harmful, it's also easier to address than disinformation. Just a little bit easier, though. People in the decent majority generally want to be correct, and most people would prefer to be told, respectfully of course, that what they thought isn't necessarily true. Many of the strategies given throughout the specialization can help with stopping the spread of misinformation. Keep in mind, though, that even if people are misinformed, they can still fall victim to many of the biases we discussed in the last lecture. Tactics like motivational interviewing, forming connections, not triggering someone's motivated reasoning are still crucially important. Disinformation is a far more concerning phenomenon. Disinformation is the intentional and malicious spread of false information. Part of why disinformation spreads is due to a lack of penalty for spreading disinformation. So for example, if I were to go into a crowded room and make a racist remark at the top of my lungs, there would be significant social penalties against me, right? However, these penalties don't currently exist in a digital sphere. People can say whatever racist or sexist or hateful comments they want without recourse. Another reason disinformation spread is because it's designed to work with our biases, to take advantage of gaps in our psychology. It's also fast and easy to make believable garbage. Remember from the last lesson, things that are easier to understand are more believable, even if the reasoning behind it is completely false. Disinformation is also designed to trigger our emotions, spur the fast thinking we talked about in the motivated reasoning unit, and in some cases cause extremism or brainwashing by altering a person's core beliefs. What is so striking to me is that the majority of disinformation, approximately 65%, comes from the same 12 people, known in the field as the disinformation dozen. They are capitalizing on inherent errors in how our brains process information to cause rifts in society. So what can we as science communicators do in the face of the disinformation dozen? First, we can protect ourselves. Always look at sources of information and teach others to do the same. Watch out for your own weak spots too. We all can be victim to biases. And teach those around you about bias and what we may or may not be likely to believe given our own backgrounds and circumstances. Another thing to watch out for is non-falsifiable hypotheses and teach what these are to others. Unfalsifiability is a logical fallacy. It's making a claim that's impossible to prove wrong. It could be something subjective, like chocolate ice cream is better than vanilla ice cream, or it could do with something that's impossible to test, like the claim that you can see God because they chose to hide themselves from you. If you try to argue a non-falsifiable hypothesis, you look like a fool, which is the point. The person spreading disinformation looks smart, and you do not, which makes you appear to anyone else watching that you are a non-reputable, non-credible source. Disinformation also tends to have a dissuasive theme. For example, one of the main focus areas for the Center for Countering Digital Hate is the spread of anti-vaccination rhetoric. I had the opportunity to hear someone from the Center for Countering Digital Hate speak at a conference. My tips for you come from his recommendations. First, raise public awareness around mis and disinformation, including the ways that people can protect themselves. I've given several examples in this talk already that you can use, plus I'll include some videos at the end of this lesson that you can also share with your following. Second, flood the world with good information that's easy to understand. There's a type of bias called a mere exposure effect. People remember things that they've seen before, even if only once. Keep availability heuristic in mind as well. People are more likely to believe information that's easy to understand. Therefore, we want to expose people to quality information that is also quick and easy to understand. Do what you can to promote others doing the same. Give them likes, comments, retweets, anything to hack those social media algorithms. Trying to derail conspiracies is an effort in futility. It takes concerted effort to unwire extreme thinking. Instead, highlight the good. Flood the world with good. Number three, don't ever feed the trolls. If you interact with a trolling post because of social media algorithms, the troll's voice gets amplified. Trolls intentionally seek out people they perceive as being powerful. This is a way to capitalize on their networks and also try to make that person in power look like a non-reputable authority. So let's say a troll is trying to interact with you. If you respond to them, it gets amplified in your network, giving them a megaphone to spread their mis or disinformation. Always block or report any trolls on social media immediately. Instead of focusing again on reversing someone's platform, minimize their ability to transmit it. They are the minority. Let's take their megaphone away. Number four, treat social media as a professional environment, even if others do not. Build your authority and your professionalism. Create answering spaces where people are comfortable coming to speak with you and not so that they seek out extremism or fear-mongering instead. If someone is fearful or anxious, you want them coming to you and not seeking disinformation.